Hello, hello, what up, what up? Welcome to Yo Sun Dynasty, the arts and culture podcast, bringing you events going on around Seoul, South Korea. It is I, your host, Candy. And for the month of December, we've got some film stuff, we've got some museum stuff, and we've got a whole lot of music stuff. So let's start with the music, shall we? First up, December 14th and 15th, that's Friday and Saturday, at Namsan Traditional Theater, there will be a musical performance featuring Jambanai and Choi Hee-sun. Jambanai, I heard of when I first came to Korea, or maybe about a year in, and they were an interesting setup. There were three of them, a guy on guitar and two women playing Korean traditional instruments. And they are an interesting mashup of like Korean folk music and punk rock, but also a lot more. One band member plays the haegeum, which is kind of similar to a fiddle. And it's been called the saddest instrument in the world. If you ever watch like a Korean movie and somebody died or is about to die, it's probably the haegeum being played in the background of that scene. It really is like this one string sorrowful instrument. But in the context of the band, it just works and sounds so diverse. The other band member plays the hyeongeum, which is kind of in the zither family. So it's this long wooden thing with like, I think 11 strings, and you play it on the floor. And it's like a full body experience, like watching her play that thing. And these two very traditional sounds mixed with the guitarist. And now I think they've added like a drummer and some other musicians that play with them live. Also this weekend is the 6th annual Korean Reggae Fest, Rise Again. You heard me. Yes, there is reggae in Korea. So if that sounds totally whack to you, you should definitely check it out. Either you'll be pleasantly surprised or you'll just get a few laughs out of seeing so many Korean people with fake locks. Either way, it's a win-win, I think. I've been to the event twice in the past, and I was introduced to a couple really fantastic bands. One is Kingston Rudiesca, which is kind of a ska band, and the other one has actually become my favorite Korean band, No Suntech and the Soul Sauce. I'm really lucky that Korean stalking laws are so lax, because I pretty much go to all their shows and stare at them and smile at them like an idiot. Their music, I don't know, it definitely fits the reggae genre, but it also is kind of jazzy, kind of funky, and just also kind of like a hard rock sound sometimes too. They pretty much convince me that whatever they want to play, they can play it better than anybody. So I'm always really excited to see them. There's also a band called Cool Running on the bill. I've never heard their music, but of course, just saying the name of the band reminds me of the movie, and that makes me so happy. There is a member of Cool Running, though, that I've met before, and his name is King Kong. King Kong has maybe the straightest teeth you'll ever see, and I think that's like worth the price of admission alone. Behold this man's glorious mouth, and maybe his songs will also be good. There is only maybe one thing that could make Rise Again maybe the perfect festival. And that would be maybe having one Jamaican person there, or one brown person from any country there. That would be really dope, I think. It's interesting because you would think, okay, in Korea, why do you expect to see brown people? That's not exactly what Korea is known for, diversity. So I do have two somewhat rational reasons why I would expect to see maybe someone from the Caribbean at a reggae festival, even if it's in Asia. One, because the first time I went to Rise Again, there were people from the culture on the bill. Like, I saw a black performer, black dancers, black people in the crowd. Then the next time I went, there were no black performers, and also, strangely enough, no black people in the crowd either. And my life in Korea is very much getting used to being the only American, the only person of color, the only woman of color, pretty much in a lot of places I go. I mean, imagine if you were in the States and you went to a hip hop festival and the only rappers were like LP, Eminem, and Post Malone. And it would be like, okay, that's cool. This is rap. But, you know, where's everybody else? It would feel like a trap, maybe. Like, is this a Klan rally in disguise or something? So it can be a little alienating to be the only when you're going to a specific culture's festival. But the second reason I also kind of expect it is because I've been to, like, the African festival in Seoul, and I was super nervous that the African festival was going to be just like a bunch of Korean people in dashikis lecturing to other Korean people about Africa. And instead, it was never just one or the other. Everywhere you look, there were Africans and Koreans and a mixture of people eating the food, wearing the clothes, and really enjoying the music. So it was like, okay, this is possible. And now that is the standard in my mind. If there's going to be like a specific cultural festival, I expect to see the locals and people from that culture represented. And so it was extra shocking to go to Rise Again and see like zero people of color. And there are probably logical reasons how that happened. Maybe every person from Jamaica and Trinidad was busy. Maybe none of them like reggae. Who knows? But if there could be some effort to include brown people in a reggae festival, besides me buying the ticket and Bob Marley's picture on the wall, that would be nice. But having no people of color in the audience, that's a really curious dilemma. I'm not sure how that happens. Do people just not know that the festival exists? Or did everybody get together and decide not to support it? Which, by the way, you guys know I don't have Twitter. So if we're boycotting something, you have to send me a text so I don't keep ending up being the only person at the reggae festival. But if you're down for, if you're into music and you're adventurous and you're willing to give it a shot, I'd say check out Rise Again on Saturday. But actually, this Saturday, I will not be at Rise Again, hashtag part of the problem, because I will be seeing The Weeknd at Gocheok Sky Dome. Incidentally, I have a friend visiting Seoul who wanted to see the concert and invited me to go along. So I am getting treated to a concert this weekend, which I think is the best way to see any concert. Ironically, right around this time last year, or actually around New Year's, another friend also treated me to the Big Bang concert before they went into the military, also at the same venue. So if anybody happens to be visiting Korea next winter, and I don't know, Anderson .Paak or Bruno Mars or Bjork happens to be in town, and you feel like you want to treat me to that show, I guess I could make myself available. So let's just keep this streak of me getting to see free shows in the winter alive. Also on Saturday, because this weekend is like the livest weekend, it seems, in Seoul, one of my favorite Korean rappers, Nuxal, is scheduled to perform at Bonita Applebaum. Again, if you know nothing about a place, but you hear it's called Bonita Applebaum, don't you just feel compelled to go? It's a year-end party from The Vault, which I guess is a clothing store, but I've never heard of it, actually. And Nuxal is pretty dope. He looks like Jasmine from The Boondocks because he used to have this big, fluffy ponytail, but his flow is really sick. Also on that lineup is R&B singer Horim, who will give you the warm and fuzzies. I've only seen him live once, but he does like those Casey and JoJo runs, like won't let a note go kind of singing. And he has a full beard, which has nothing to do with his talent, but you just don't see that much on an Asian face. And it's pretty impressive. There are dancers and a bunch of DJs on that lineup too. Horem actually is performing next weekend also at Hyundai Understage. That venue is pretty cool because it is home to a music library in Hanamdong, but the Understage is the concert space under the library. And it's just a really nice venue to see a show in. It's like a nice basement instead of like the grungy basements that you might go see like a little punk band in or something. So it's pretty cool. Let's pause on music and switch gears to museums this month. And this is actually a long-running exhibition, but at the Seoul Museum of History, going until March 10th, is a special exhibition of donated relics under the title Dilkusha and Chain of Amber. Dilkusha is the name of a house that an expat couple, Albert and Mary Taylor, used to live in during the early 20th century in Korea. The house is evidently located right in Jongno, and it has the history of this couple in it. Albert Taylor used to own a gold mine in Korea, which I didn't even know there were gold mines in Korea. He met his future wife on a business trip to Japan. They got married in India, and then they settled down and had their son in Korea. So the items on display show Korea during that time through the eyes of non-natives, which makes me kind of curious, like, what things did they see back then that might be similar to what I, as like a 21st century expat here, might also have seen or be seeing, I guess. Also, another museum thing, this is actually two events at the same art center. At Art Sungjae Center, there is an exhibition going until January 20th called One a Day. And it's three artists, a Korean traditional vocalist, a sculptor who uses industrial materials, and a painter. And they're kind of uniting their talents in this exhibition to explore the process of creating art and performance and what happens when these different media come together. I am particularly interested in what the Korean traditional vocalist will do, because apart from everything that's on view every day, Park Min-hee does a 70-minute performance at the center like five times during the run. So the remaining performances are December 15th and 22nd and January 12th and 16th. And I'm not totally sure how it connects to the exhibition exactly, but it sounds very dramatic and I'm all for the extraness of it. So I'm going to be checking that out soon. Also at Art Sungjae Center is Play for Today, which is a film lecture and screening series. And I just love it when museums like have music and show films, because yes, you should appreciate the art, but it's nice for them to like engage you in other ways as well. And it really seems like this place, I'm not sure if I've been to this center before, but they've got a little bit of everything going on. So Play for Today, their last film screening will be December 20th. And it's a screening of a film called Red Hollywood, a documentary about the Hollywood blacklist and some of the affected artists telling their stories. It sounds just a little different maybe from other films about the blacklist, simply because it's not like it's a communist denial story, but instead these artists are acknowledging their political leanings and why they felt it was necessary for their films to do that during that time. So this movie isn't new. I think it came out in 1996, but it's one I've never seen and it sounds interesting. So I'll be checking that out as well. So, you know, not free, but as close to free as you can kind of get. Even if you're on a budget, you get to see a whole movie. You get to see a performance. Sounds like good stuff. For today's interview, we will be taking a glimpse behind the scenes of the soul hip hop scene through the eyes of DJ and producer The Z. And as usual, Eddie will be providing interpretation for us to go from English to Korean and back again so we can keep the conversation flowing. So Z, could you please introduce yourself for us?
Yeah. What's up? My name is The Z and I'm the number one DJ and turntablist and producer in Korea. Hi. Oh. Nice to meet you, everyone.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah.
Nice to meet you.
First question. How were you first introduced to hip hop?
So, hip hop은 어떻게 처음 알았나요?
예, 힙합은 사실 제가 어렸을 때는 한국에서는 그렇게 유명한 장르도 아니었고 유명한 뮤지션도 있는 게 아니었는데 그 당시 때 AFKN이라는 채널이 있었어요. 주한 미국 방송, 미군 방송이 있었는데 저희 집에 나왔어요. 그 채널이. 그래서 그때 아마 아메리칸 뮤직 어워드 때 LL Cool J랑 DJ Jazz F의 공연하는 거 보고 그때 너무 인상적이었거든요. 그래서 그때 너무 멋있어서 그때 처음 접했습니다.
So his first when he was younger, he actually hip hop wasn't a big genre in Korea. But when he was younger, it happened to there was a channel in Korea called
AFKN.
AFKN, which showcased a lot of hip hop, and he actually got that channel in his household. So he watched it while he was younger, and he saw LL Cool J and
Mama Said Not Cure and DJ Jeff. Wow, what's that?
I'm going.
Ah, yeah, yeah.
Parents just don't understand.
Yeah. I forgot the title. Yeah.
Yeah. But he saw those kind of artists and he got a very good impression and he was amazed by that. Mm-hmm. So that's when he was first introduced to hip hop.
Okay, cool. And so how did you go from being a hip hop fan to wanting to be in hip hop and do something with hip hop?
그래서 이제 hip hop fan 하다가 언제 어떻게 hip hop artist로 이제 넘어갔어요?
사실 그때 처음 LL Cool J랑 DJ JZF를 본 경우 중학생이었는데요. 이 한국에선 고등학생이 되면 이제 조금 진로를 결정해야 돼요. 뭐 문과도 있고 이과도 있는데 그 전에 그냥 저는 딱 고등학생이 되는 순간 음악을 해야겠다. 이게 내 길이다라는 생각을 하게 됐죠. 그래서 그때 이후에 계속 그냥 공부를 사실 그냥 이 힙합 음악이 아닌 대중 가요, 그러니까 막 팝 음악을 공부를 했었는데. 20살 딱 되는 순간부터 아 그냥 힙합만 해야겠다 다른 거 생각 안 하고 힙합만 해야겠다라는 생각을 했었고요. DJing은 사실 한국의 스크래치라는 이런 장르가 좀 많이 유명하지 않았어요. 그때도 마찬가지로 턴테이블은 비교적 지금보다는 쉽게 구할 수 있었지만 이 스크래치라는 걸 정확한 개념이 없었는데 그때는 일본에서 온 교포 친구들이 많이 이런 걸 알려줬었죠. 그래서 그 21, 22 그때 외국 일본 교포 친구들 만나면서 또 이 옛날 가리온에 했던 제이 형이라는 사람을 알게 되면서 그때 스크래치 DJ 문화에 대해 관심이 생겼고 그때 조금씩 연습을 하고 준비를 하다가 너무 빠져들게 됐죠. 예.
So in Korea, typically from middle school to transitioning to high school, students have to decide what they want to do for the rest of their life. And so he just wanted to do music. Still, he didn't want to do like hip hop in general. It's just like he wanted to do music. He's like, oh, this is the way I should go. So when he went from middle school to high school, he was like, okay, I want to study music. So he still enjoyed hip hop, but he wanted to study all music because hip hop wasn't still popular. So he did a lot of pop and things like that. And when he became 20, he's like, yes, my type of genre is hip-hop. So that's when he chose hip-hop. And DJing and scratch, he actually learned from his friends that came from Japan. And at that time, it was easy to get turntables and things like that, but it still wasn't popular. But he got introduced and learned a lot about it through his friends from Japan. And that's when he was in around 20.
Okay. So when we're talking about like that time, that's what mid late 90s? Hmm?
Late 90s.
Late 90s.
Okay.
Yeah.
So hip hop was already a thing in Japan, and your friends, yeah, right. your Japanese friends,
yeah.
could school you on it a yeah. little bit. Okay. All right. So then were you ever, if it wasn't popular, like now you can go to DJ schools and DJ academies, but you didn't have that option then. Mm. You just had to learn informally, or did you have training?
Yeah.
그때는 이제 그렇게 안 유명했으면 이제 학교 DJ 합격도 없고 뭐 선생님도 많이 없었을 건데 예. 어떻게 가르쳐서 혼자 배웠는지
그 부분에 대해서 좀 그때는 지금처럼 유튜브 이런 게 좀 많이 발달되지 않고 사실 그 일본 친구들이 오면서 어떤 그 스크래치 레슨 비디오 이런 게 있었어요. 그 영상을 보고 같이 연습을 했죠. 왜냐하면 소리에 대해서 정확히 이해가도가 떨어지긴 하는데 그래서 비슷하게 소리를 내려고 굉장히 노력을 했어요. 예, 그리고 뭐 그 다음에 아마 제가 기억나는 건 DVD도 좀 나왔었고 그리고 2000년에 아마 제 기억엔 스크래치콘이라는 그런 그 세미나 뭐 이런 게 있었는데 그 비디오도 좀 구해서 보고 그랬죠. 예.
So, I mean, in the beginning, he actually just learned through a lot of his Japanese friends who brought over some DVDs and videos of scratch, and then he would try to imitate them, right? Like, try to make the exact sound that he saw in the video. And then at that time, because there was no YouTube at that time, it's still pretty early. And then there was also a Scratch Con, so it's like a conference where he would get some videos from there and just learn through that. So at that time, it was just through, you know, self learning through videos that he was able to get a hands on.
And so you mentioned before you have friends who were into hip hop from Japan, and even now you perform in Japan sometimes, like throughout the year. So is there a difference that you've noticed between hip hop audiences in Japan versus the audience you play for here in Korea?
그래서 이제 일본 친구도 배우고 알고 해서 이제 일본 많이 가봤는데 일본 팬들랑 한국 팬들랑 뭐 차이가 어떻게 돼요?
아, 그게 진짜 사실 거리로는 굉장히 가까운 나라잖아요. 근데 너무 성향이 정반대예요. 그러니까 한국 팬들은 굉장히 에너제틱해요. 그러니까 좋아하는 음악 나오면 계속 끝까지 열심히 노는데 일본 분들은 일본 가보셨나요? 일본 가봤죠. 예, 일본 사람들은 너무 조용해요. 그리고 거기도 마찬가지예요. 그래서 에미넴이 일본에서 공연하고 한국에서 공연했을 때 반응이 달랐던 이유를 저는 알겠어요. 왜냐하면 일본 사람들은 와 이런 환호성도 많이 안 질러요. 왜냐하면 다른 사람들 피해 준다고 생각하니까. 근데 뭐 이 정도, 그냥 이 정도, 이 정도지 한국 사람처럼 와 이러진 않아요. 근데 그게 저는 처음에 갔을 때 물어봤어요. 저 소개해줬던 누나한테 저 진짜 잘 튼 거냐고, 잘한 거냐고 그러니까 너무 잘했다고. 예, 일본 사람들 이게 진짜 좋은 반응이라고 얘기하더라고요. 예, 그래서 한국 사람들은 좀 뜨겁고 일본 사람들은 조용해요. Yeah.
So, in Korea, Korean fans are very energetic, right? When they and they have so much energy throughout the whole concert or whole set or whatever, they're just like cheering and loud and dancing and whatever. But when you go to Japan, culture-wise, it's very quiet in Japan when you walk around, right? So, and that's the same as at the venue or concert, wherever. They are pretty quiet. They don't want to... They don't want to cheer and like bother the person next to them. That's kind of their mindset.
At a concert?
Yeah, right. Even concert. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So that's, I mean, that's their mindset. So they like the most they will do is kind of like raise their hands and then maybe clap a little bit, but they're not really screaming or anything. So, and one time when he first went to Japan, he actually asked the person who was the connection and asked, oh, did I do a good job? Because he didn't know the reaction was like that. So, and then they were like, yes, you know, this is their normal reaction when they have a good time. So,
okay. Like a golf clap.
Right. Yeah, 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 yeah.
Thank you, sir, for coming. Okay. What do you think is appealing to Korean people about hip hop? Obviously, you can't speak for the nation, but just your impression. Why is it kind of big or growing here?
So, 힙합은 이제 한국에서 왜 이렇게 많이 이제 좋아지고 이제 popular 되고 그런 거 생각하는 거, 왜 생각했는지.
그거는 뭐 이렇게 다른 사람들이 오해하실 수 있고 좀 이렇게 그러실 수 있지만 제 생각에는 사실 힙합은 젊은이 문화, 젊은 사람들의 문화이긴 한데요. 그만큼 에너지가 있어서 젊은 사람들이 여기로 들어오기 좀 쉬운 것 같아요. 사실 예전에는 저희 세대 때는 락 음악이 굉장히 그런 장르의 음악이었는데 요즘은 그런 힙합이 락은 사실 혼자긴 힘들잖아요. 막 기타도 있어야 되고 드럼도 있어야 되는데 힙합은 혼자 할 수 있고 그리고 요즘엔 사실 개인주의가 많아지니까 혼자 할 수 있는 뭔가를 찾는데 그게 힙합이고 또 자기를 표현할 수 있는 거가 되는 거고 그리고 그 외에 그냥 하는 사람 말고 팬들의 입장에서 보면 사람들은 스토리를 좋아하잖아요. 그래서 이 사람의 스토리를 듣고 싶은 거라고 생각합니다. 예.
So he thinks nowadays hip hop has a lot of energy and it's a more younger crowd. And that's why a lot of people on both sides as a DJ as a lot of hip hop artists are coming into hip hop because it is for a young crowd. It used to be like in the 90s back, like it was kind of rock. But rock, you need a guitarist, you need a lead singer, you can't do it by yourself. But this is more like hip hop you can do by yourself. And so a lot of people are becoming hip hop artists because of that reason. There has a lot of energy and it's more for the younger crowd in Korea. And also for as a fan aspect, fans like the story of the hip hop artist, right? Mm-hmm. So hip hop, you're kind of telling a story, the struggles or whatever, but the fans liked hearing the story of the artist, and so they enjoyed that part.
Okay. Yeah, the storytelling is huge, I think, for American fans too, or international fans, whoever. So, but do Korean rappers tell similar stories? Because I listen to Korean hip hop for the beat, because I have no idea what they're saying, and it. To look at the translated version kind of ruins it for me.
Yeah.
So I just don't care what they're saying usually. But are they trying to tell stories about like their struggles usually in Korean hip hop?
Because hip hop artist, 한국 hip hop artist는 story 얘기하는 거예요 많이 아니면?
반반인 것 같아요. 스토리를 얘기를 많이 하는 DJ 래퍼들도 있고요. 그리고 아니면 그냥 이렇게 캐치프레이즈만 계속 얘기하는 DJ 그 래퍼들도 있고요. 반반인 것 같아요. 근데 조금 더 스토리를 팬들도 마찬가지예요. 스토리를 좋아하는 팬들도 있는데 그냥 아니면 그냥 말장난처럼 이렇게 멤블링처럼 그냥 뭐 간단한 캐치프레이즈 계속 반복되는 것만 좋아하는 팬들도 있어요. 예.
So he thinks it's about half a half. Like there's a half artists who tell stories and then there's the other half that's just like coming up with like catchphrases or popular, you know, slang or like mumbling in Korean.
Okay.
And the same as for fans, like there's people who really like the stories and then there's other fans who just really like the beat and just like the catchphrases and so he says it's about half-half.
Okay. For me, like I grew up, I'm like the hip-hop generation, like a child of hip-hop too. And I tend to think of it as black music because those are the main people I've ever seen do it. Mm-hmm. And the stories that they're telling are usually about the black experience. Mm-hmm. So then it was kind of funny for me to come to Korea and you don't see like, you can, but you can see like a hip hop club or something like that. But when you see like black music lounge, I'm like, oh, okay. Like, so literally, this is a place to hear black music. Mm. And we don't even do that in the States. So, part one, do Koreans see hip-hop as black music? Mm. Or, like, music for anybody, I guess.
So, 처음에는 이제 어렸을 때 힙합은 뉴욕에서 자랐으니까 이제 힙합은 좀 많이 들고 이제 자랐는데 그래서 이제 흑인 사람들 많이 노래로 생각했는데 한국 와서도 이제 뭐 어디 가게 보면 이제 black music 써 있는데 그렇게 해서 한국 사람은 어떻게 힙합은 흑인 사람 노래인 줄 보이는지 아니면 그냥 노래 뮤직 쪽으로 보이는지
사실 다 아시겠지만 이 힙합은 진짜 흑인 문화 그대로잖아요 저 현 시대를 살고 있는 흑인 문화 그대로인데 한국에서도 마찬가지로 그렇게 받아들이고 있어요. 흑인 문화. 시작은 흑인 문화인데 사실 한국에서는 그 나름대로의 이제 자랐죠. 그 나름대로 자랐지만 이게 기본적으로 흑인 문화라는 건 알고 있고요. 그런 것도 같아요. 소울, 뭐 재즈, 펑크 다 흑인 문화라고 알고 있어요. 예. 그거는 그렇습니다. 예.
So, I mean everybody in Korea knows like hip-hop it originally from like black people, like their life, their culture, their struggles and everything like that. And Koreans don't understand that. And know like it's that's the origin and like they understand, you know, like jazz and other genres are also, you know, from the black culture.
Okay. Cool. Then how far does that go? Do you think Korean people also like Korean black culture and black people or just kind of like the fashion and the music of it?
한국 사람들은 이제 힙합 들을 때 뭐 좋아하는 사람들은 힙합만 이제 컬처만 좋아할까요? 아니면 이제 흑인 뭐 흑인 사람들랑 뭐 다 좋아할까요?
그게 좀 재밌는 질문인데요. 사실 제 생각은 그렇습니다. 힙합만 좋아하는 것 같아요. 그러니까 흑인 문화를 좋아하는 사람들은 좀 그 힙합을 좋아하는 사람들보다 적어요. 왜냐하면 제가 처음에 음악 예일예로 이럴 거예요 아마 블랙팬서라고 사람들이 블랙팬서는 영화로만 알고 있지 그 이렇게 이런 무브먼트라고 알고 있는 사람들 거의 없어요 한국에서는 예 그게 아마 답이 됐을 것 같아요.
So he thinks most people probably just like the black culture, like just the hip hop part, because even in his experience when he asks like, oh, do you like Black Panther? They think about the movie. They don't think about the Black Panther actual movement. Right? Okay. So, I mean, he thinks, I mean, it's a good question. It's a very, you know, interesting question. But he thinks, yeah, Koreans probably, there's a small percentage that would actually like the whole, like everything is just like the music part is more of the majority.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think there's a gap.
Maybe, yeah, yeah.
Just because we're not here.
Yeah. and even... 젊은 사람들은 20대들은 아마 마이클 조던은 그냥 신발 브랜드라고 할 거예요. 예, 마이클 조던 모를 거예요 아마.
So right now, even like if you think about like the 20s, everybody who's in the 20s thinks Michael Jordan is just the shoe. You know, they haven't experienced it through watching him play basketball, so they just like, oh, they're just talking about the shoe.
Okay, alright, that's interesting.
Yeah.
I want to know some of your. I want to hear about your taste. A little bit in music. So, could you name three rappers that you would recommend to Korean hip hop fans? It doesn't have to be American rappers, but international hip hop. If it ends up being American, that's okay too. Because you know we do it.
Yeah.
So,
DJ로 다른 이제 한국 팬들한테 international DJ 아니면 hip hop rapper 소개하면 이거 top 3를 누구로 고를 거예요?
올타임 탑 3인가요?
뭐 그냥 이제 팬 앞에 와서 팬 와서 이제 누구 좋아해요? 그러면 이제 세 명 얘기하면
세 명이요?
네.
And why?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
That's an essay question.
Yeah. Number one Jay-Z. 예. 그리고 예. 이유는 90년대부터 지금까지 그냥 얼타임이니까. 왜냐면 안 들으면 사실 지금의 힙합이 어떻게 이렇게 왔는지를 모르는 거예요. 왜냐면 예전에 붐뱁도 했었고 뭐 더리 사우스 같은 것도 했었고 트랩도 했었고 이 90년대 이후의 힙합의 흐름은 이제 제이지인 것 같아요. 예.
So number one, Jay-Z is number one. The reason is he started in the 90s and he's still continuing today, right? But if you don't know hip hop's like history, then he feels like he won't understand. So like Jay-Z is kind of like represents that. He went through all the different phases of like boom rap and trap and things like that. So that's number one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fine. Mm-hmm. Numero dos.
아 2위는 사실 제가 그렇게 좋아하지는 않는데요. Eminem. Eminem을 생각한 이유가요. Eminem은 백인이잖아요. 근데 백인인데 흑인 문화를 할 수 있다는 걸 보여줬고 그러면서 다른 인종들도 이제 같이 이제 힙합이란 장르를 공유하게 된 사람인 것 같아요. 예.
So number two would be Eminem. Even though I'm not a big fan of Eminem, like he would, he says he would have to say Eminem because Eminem's white, right? And he came into like you see, because hip hop is considered a black culture. So it's he came in and he's still one of the top rappers. So and because of him, other races came into hip hop. So it would be Eminem.
Okay, so he's kind of like a, barrier breaker? I don't know. He's different, but also different.
Yeah.
Trailblazer. Okay.
Yeah.
Fine. Three.
마지막으로 드레이크요. 드레이크 사실 이게 커머셜로는 되게 성공한 뮤지션인데 지금 들어야 하는 이유가 왜 사람들이 드레이크를 좋아하는지 그리고 왜 드레이크의 음악을 사람들이 좋아하는지 알게 되는 이런 지금 현 시대를 살아가는 사람들은 알게 될 것 같아요. 드레이크. 예.
So number three would be Drake. And the reason is if you listen to Drake, you kind of see why or you have to try to you'll find out why people really like him and what people are interested in, right? Because he's very popular, right? So what he raps about is what's... He's very commercialized, right? So, I mean, if you listen to his music, you kind of feel the sense of what the society is kind of enjoying nowadays and then see what is popular.
Okay. All right. I get it.
Oh, don't get it twisted.
No, I'm not angry. I'm not gonna flip the table over. but no, that's true. I mean, because I ignored Drake for a long time. I still have never heard a complete Drake album. But he wouldn't go away. So I was like, oh, I guess I have to listen to this guy because he's everywhere.
Yeah.
It's a little bit like K-pop here.
Yeah.
Like, if you don't like K-pop, you still know all the songs because it's just... You can't buy a coffee without hearing all the songs all the time. So.
And plus, he's a work hard.
He works hard.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. What about for the international fan who wants to know, where do I begin with good Korean hip hop? Who should I be listening to? Top three.
Top three. Oh, God.
Yeah. 이제 외국 사람들 와서 이제 한국 힙합 이제 배우려면 아니면 누구한테 이제 들으려면 탑3 누구 할 거예요?
일단은 저는 넘버원은 가리온. 가리온은 제가 친해서 그런 건 아니고요. 마찬가지 제이지랑 왜냐면 90년대에서부터 음악을 시작해갖고 지금까지 사실 힙합 팀이 15년 거의 20년 가까이 유지된다는 건 쉽지 않은 일이거든요. 그러면서 그 사람들이 음악을 만들고 시대가 변하고 그러면서 그들의 음악도 바뀌는 걸 들으면 사실 90년대 후반이 한국에서 힙합이 태어난 시기거든요. 그때부터 지금까지 계속 음악을 했다는 건 태어난 순간부터 지금까지 계속 했다는 건 한국의 음악이 힙합 음악이 바뀌었다는 바뀌는 그 상황을 볼 수 있으니까요. 예.
So number would be 게리온?
가리온.
가리온.
예. 예.
So
Garyon.
My friend.
yeah, it's his friend, but it's not. I mean, it is his friend, but it's not the main reason because. He actually is kind of like Jay-Z, similar to Jay-Z. He started in the 90s, and he still lasted to now. And so, and in the 90s is basically when hip-hop started in Korea. So if you listen to his music, you kind of can see the changes and the different types of hip-hop that went through Korea. And so I would recommend Gary.
I thought Gary was a group?
Or yeah,
was oh, okay.
Duo.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's a duo.
Cool.
All right. Mm-hmm. And
Drunk Tiger.
Okay.
Drunk Tiger. 이거는 마찬가지예요. 그 시작도 비슷한 시기긴 했었지만 사실 데뷔는 조금 메이저 기획사에서 메이저 컴퍼니에서 데뷔했는데 점점 그 분들이 음악이 뭐 누구지? DJ 샤인 나가고 Drunk Tiger JK 혼자서 음악을 했지만 그 어떤 힙 팝 특히 미국의 좀 느낌이 가장 강했던 분이지 않을까 생각하고 있습니다. 예.
So number two would be Drunken Tiger. So they also started in the 90s. They were by major
company.
Company. They were signed by major company. And then but then throughout their history, you know, DJ Shine left, and then it was only Tiger JK by himself. But he, Drunken Tiger would probably be the closest to American style. So probably Drunken Tiger.
Okay.
Number three is 이번에 크루인데 비스 메이저요. 비스 메이저라고 디플로 있고 넉살 있고 덤밀스 우탄 이런 그 크루인데 사실 요즘 나온 친구들 중에 가장 열심히 하고 있는 제 생각에 가장 열심히 하는 친구들 같고요. 그리고 음악도 좀 다양한 색깔을 내고 그리고 뭐 트랩이던 붐뱁이던 자기네들이 표현할 수 있는 걸 여실히 제대로 보여줄 수 보여주고 있는 친구들인 것 같아요. 예.
So the third would be
크루 비스 메이저.
VMC.
Yeah.
VMC major. Yeah. So they are, it's actually a crew. So it's a group of people. Mm. And if you listen to they are working very hard. So they're like more now like right now popular. Yeah. Mm. So they and then there's different styles. Everybody has their own kind of style, like boom rap and trap and things like that. So if you listen to their whole group, then you kind of get the vibe of Korean hip hop.
Okay. Mm. All right. Cool. Mm-hmm. You pleased with yourself? Like the sweat.
Yeah.
Okay. So Nooksal is in UMC.
Yeah. Right.
But did that crew exist before he was on Show Me the Money?
Mm-hmm.
Right. That crew was before the reality show.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, wait a minute. Uh-huh. Don't breathe yet. If you could add a fourth? Because you gave two old school options and only one kind of new school. So could you throw in another current good hip hop?
So 지금
option?
이제 세 명에서는 두 명은 old school, 이제 좀 오래된 가수들이고 이제 마지막이 좀 요즘 근데 한 명 더 요즘 좀
요즘
for the people who absolutely hate old school hip hop. Then what is something new?
오래된 것 좀 싫어하면 이제 요즘 힙합.
도끼. 예, 도끼.
Billionaire.
Billionaire.
Never mind. Okay. Is that just because he's rich?
Yeah. 아, 아니. 꼭 그런 건 아니고요.
Not just because he's rich.
예. 근데 가장 중요한 건 제가 꼽는 이유 중에 가장 중요한 건 뭐냐면 열심히 하는 사람들이에요. 왜냐하면 예를 들어서 제가 음악가예요. 아니에요. 농구선수인데 농구게임 안 하면서 내가 농구선수라고 말할 수는 없잖아요. 축구선수인데 축구를 안 하고 내가 축구선수를 말할 수 없는 것처럼 음악가도 뭐 이건 예를 들어서요. 롤링힐을 20년 전에 앨범 하나 내고 내가 뮤지션이라고 말하는 건 조금 웃기지 않나라는 생각을 하고 있습니다. 예. 그래서,
so, the reason why he's picking all these people, one reason is because they work very hard, right? If you look at like a basketball player or a soccer player who's like, doesn't even really play and calls himself, oh, I'm a basketball player, I'm a soccer player. Or, and for his example, as an example, it's like, if Lauryn Hill 20 years ago just made one album and said, oh, I'm a musician, it's kind of not fair, right? It's kind of, so he considers actual musicians who, you know, perfect their craft and just work really hard at it.
I'll allow it. Are you playing somewhere that we should know?
아, 제가 매주 금요일, 토요일은 홍대클럽 DISS 디스라는 데서 음악을 트니까 만약에 여기 듣고 계신 분들이 와서 저한테 캔디스 안다고 얘기하면 제가 프리로 뭔가를 예.
So every Friday, Saturday, he DJs at Club DISS. So, and for you guys listening, if you come and tell him, oh, I'm Candace's friend, he will give you a free drink.
Yeah.
I don't know any of these people. Well, okay, there's motivation to go out in a freezing cold weekend. Because you get a free drink out of it.
오늘은 눈이 왔죠. Snowing.
Today it snowed.
Yeah.
Beautiful winter wonderland. Thank you so much, Lizzie.
Thanks
AKA
a lot.
Velose,
yeah.
AKA, who knows, whatever your government name is.
Yeah.
Thanks for talking to us. Thank
감사합니다.
You, Eddie, for helping us understand what's going on.
Well, that brings us to the end of episode 2 of Yo Son Dynasty. We did it, Brooklyn. Thanks again to the Z and Eddie. For this month's soul sound, I am cheating because it actually comes from a city called Gapyeong, which is slightly northeast of Seoul. It's like a 90-minute train ride. And Gapyeong is kind of a poppin' little nook outside of the city. It's got a couple islands, one that is home to an annual jazz festival. It's got a ski resort. But I went to Gapyeong with my good friend Ralph Machia, who also documents her artistic adventures at Ralph Machia on Instagram, so you can check that out. We did the Gapyeong Rail Park, which is like this seated, self-powered pedal bike down an abandoned railway. I'm not sure why we waited until the coldest possible day to enjoy this outdoor excursion, but you live, you learn, you freeze. So let the sound of our limbs freezing and cracking ease you into your weekend and try to imagine the rolling hills and the crystal clear stream and the rickety old shacks we were passing while trying to retain the feeling in our feet. Maybe you don't want to necessarily do an outdoor activity like that in December, but whatever you do, remember to get out of the house and find your soul. Catch you next time. Ciao, ciao.